December 8th, 1997 meeting of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. I'm sorry we're a minute or so late. There's a wonderful concert of the 6th and 7th grade at the high school tonight, and I think half the town is there. And I think it's certainly a wonderful community activity, and schools should be commended. The clerk is not here tonight, is that correct?
That's right.
Illness in the family? So I take it you will do the roll call.
I'll have that honor. Counselor Berry?
Here.
Counselor Byer?
Present.
Counselor Fritz?
Here.
Counselor Jordan?
Yeah.
Counselor McGinty?
Here.
Counselor Reed?
Here.
Chairman Groff?
Here. We have the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Is there a citizen that would like to bring something to the attention of the town council that is not on the agenda this evening?
Mr. Chairman, if I might just take a moment, I know I'm on the council, but I would like to commend the rescue unit and the Cape Elizabeth Police. Greg Kinsman was the officer on duty, and Counselor McGinty and the members of the rescue unit who responded to my home 3 weeks ago tomorrow. My wife had the misfortune to fracture her ankle in the slipping in the driveway. And they were just wonderful. And they took her into the hospital. She had to have surgery with 9 screws in her ankle, and it was a very serious injury. And the Cape Elizabeth Rescue Unit were just wonderful. And I want the people to know that we're most grateful and we're fortunate to have that wonderful resource in this community. And I commend Councilor McGinty and the members of the team who responded. And thank you very much.
Thank you.
Before we get to reports and correspondence, are there any citizens that wish to discuss anything? Hearing none. Now we can move to reports and correspondence. Are there any councilors?
Mr. Chairman, the County Budget Committee, I've been meeting with them all fall as the representative of the council. And we have some good news and some bad news. The good news is that the dollar amount projected for the upcoming budget for 1998 is not expected to increase over the last year's amount. However, in order to achieve that, the county commissioners have to rely on revenues to make up an additional operating budget. And when they do put the two together, they expect that there will be no dollar increase. The budget is approximately $17,600,000 for the county for the year, and Cape Elizabeth's portion is approximately $500,000.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Any other councilors' reports and or correspondence? Many of you, I'm sure most of you, have received a solicitation for Field for Cape Kids. Most of you probably understand at this point in time that there are athletic fields in the Cape that are going to be built with a combination of town input and private donations. I am going to tonight give a check for $500, which is pretty much my after-tax salary with being on the town council for 3 years. I'm going to give that to the town for Field for Kids, because I just think this is one of the more important things as a community that we can do, having the public sector and the private sector work together and provide these recreational activities for our children. So, Mr. McGovern?
Thank you, sir.
And I hope many of you at home also support this endeavor. Other reports and correspondence. The minutes of the previous meeting number 9 held on November 10th, 1997. Is there a motion?
I'll move that it be accepted as printed.
Second.
All in favor? 7-0. The minutes are approved. The first item tonight is item number 63. This item was tabled on the last meeting until tonight, and I believe it would be appropriate, especially for those at home, to have a brief introduction concerning where we are, and perhaps the town manager could elucidate us. Councilor George.
I'll make a motion that we remove an item from the table.
Is there a second? Councilor Fritz, second. All in favor? The item's been removed from the table, and now if the town manager would provide a brief synopsis.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. At the last town council meeting in November, the town council was considering whether or not to approve the design review committee report on the Two Lakes Bikeway pedestrian path. At about the time they were voting, it was moving very close to a vote, and then there was a motion to table it, which passed 6-1 request, and as not necessarily as part of the motion, I don't recall, but as sort of certainly part of the discussion, it was suggested that we review with the Maine Department of Transportation what our options might be on the project. Primarily as a result of that discussion, there would appear to be four options. One is to approve the recommended design for the Two Lakes Bikeway pedestrian path as was proposed in last month's agenda packet, in essence the report coming from the design review committee. Second is both MDOT and PACS, which is the Regional Transportation Funding Agency, have indicated that if there are excess funds in a project or if a project is not going to go forward, that the funds could be transferred to another project, provided that project is underfunded, not fully funded, over budget, depending on which way you want to look at that. In the case of the town of Cape Elizabeth, we have two such projects. One is the town center sidewalk drainage project, and the second is a traffic light, walk signal light at the intersections of Scott Dyer Road, Route 77, and Shore Road. The MDOT did indicate that funds could be transferred to those projects. They also indicated that some of the funds that went into the Two Lakes project that had come from a cost savings on the placement of a culvert on Sawyer Road that was done at considerable savings by our public works crew could be placed, could be either kept on Two Lakes Road or moved to one of those other projects that I mentioned. And if it was kept on Two Lakes Road, it does not necessarily have to be for the bikeway pedestrian path per se. It could be used for something else in that project area. So in summary, the options are to approve the bikeway pedestrian path as proposed, to authorize me to indicate to PACS and MDOT that we would take some action on Two Lakes Road. What was suggested in the discussions with MDOT was to do a pavement overlay of the road from Route 77 to Two Lakes State Park, as well as to do some drainage work at an estimated cost of $80,000. And along with that, there'd still be a balance of funds. It suggested that those go to the town center sidewalk drainage project, which includes, in MDOT parlance now, the traffic light as well. The third option is to do nothing on Two Lakes Road, have all of the funds go to the town center sidewalk drainage project, and the fourth option is to indicate to MDOT and to PACS that the town is not interested in the federal and state funds, predominantly federal funds, and in essence return them to the state and indicate that we don't want to do the Two Lakes project. That is a quick summary of a lot of material that's been given to the council and I think was also fairly well reported on in the Cape Courier as well.
Mr. Chairman, I would like to make a motion. I would like to make a motion that the council adopt the second choice of the that the manager has just explained, so that a portion of these funds are dedicated to the Two Lakes Road and that the balance of it we put in the sidewalk drainage project as written.
Is there a second?
Second it.
I'll second that.
Councilor McGinty seconds.
I have a question for the town manager, if I could.
Certainly.
Is there any reason that
as part of the paving of Two Lights Road, that we can't do shoulder improvements that would improve safety in certain areas of that road?
Right.
The shoulder improvements, even within the $80,000, contemplate an improved gravel shoulder in those areas where there is a gravel shoulder. It does not contemplate additional widening of paving. That could be done somewhat, but, you know, I think that's a judgment of the council as to, you know, whether or not that should be done. But there could be some widening of the paving. It would have to be limited within those available funds.
We could allocate additional funds, though, if we so desired.
That's correct.
Fine.
Discussion on the motion. Councilor Reed.
Mr. Chairman, because this could at least be redundant, if not worse, is there any reason why we couldn't go down the items and discuss and vote yay or nay on each one as they come up? The reason I mention that is, although I may ultimately decide to support item two, I would not be willing to do that without further discussion of three and four. And of course, my favorite, making a motion to approve the recommended design for Two Lights Road bikeway.
The chair rules that the discussion concerning this particular motion, since it's one pot of money, that any councillor may discuss any of these options as part of the discussion of Councillor Barry's motion. So you, there's no particular order, but you may discuss any use of this motion, but the only, any use of these funds, but the only motion on the floor at this time is Councilor Barry's motion.
All right, Matt. Part of my concern, having served on the Town Center Planning Committee, is that I believe that it's been a while since several members had looked at that design in depth. There have been major modifications in it, and there are three town councilors voting tonight who have not been part of the workshop or the extended discussions of that project. And I'm concerned that we have a tendency to request grant money and then refuse it, and I would hate to have this appear as though we're not giving support to the Town Center sidewalk drainage project to the extent that we should, since that project has been pending for at least 4 years.
So any other discussion? Councilor Fritz.
I'm concerned about the, well, there's an amount for $40,000 in the for the traffic light, and I'm not ready to commit to spending money for that particular project, but I would very much like to see 2 foot wide paved shoulders in the area from Hannaford Cove to the state park, done at the same time as we're repaving Two Lights Road.
With what particular funds?
The $80,000.
I would prefer spending $40,000 at this point without further information instead of on the light to put that into paving at the same time. If that, I don't know what the cost of the 2 foot shoulders might be for that area. Maybe we need to have further information. I think it would be cheaper to do while we were paving the rest of the road rather than adding shoulders later. So I'd like to know the amount that would be. I think that would be a decided improvement over just doing gravel shoulders and improving the gravel shoulders in that area.
I agree.
Further discussion? Councilor Byer.
Thank you. I have a question just to make sure that I understand what Mike has provided us for information. If item number two were taken, which as I understand it is an $80,000, at least it was without what Councilor Fritz has just described, perhaps costing more, but if it's that 80, then Mike, it's totaled up in here and it would suggest that the Town Center plan could still be done within the budgetary money. Am I reading this correctly?
Yes, Councilor. It's it can be done, but it's very close once you keep $80,000 on Two Lights to do the proposed scope of the Town Center project here, which is a sidewalk on one side of Scott Dyer from Longfellow excuse me, from Farm Hill Road to Jordan Way, and also significant drainage in that corridor as well, including a very expensive drainage pipe that extends from Route 77 into the school complex, a solid ledge, and it's an important drainage line.
And if I could just follow up then to further understand that, then if they were exactly correct in terms of their estimates, which none of us are going to expect anyone is, that would be a close fit. And the give and take, which Councilor Fritz suggested, might be the 40,000 in the traffic light, but we don't know what the 2-foot, what are we going to call them?
Paved shoulders.
Shoulders, yeah. What that would cost. Thank you.
The 2-foot, you can do, I don't know the exact cost of 2-foot paved shoulders. Mm-hmm. Now, I think, you know, one of the difficulties is when you look at the whole Two Lights design review process, you know, it was very clear from the citizens who were opposed to the project that they didn't want 2 feet placed on either side of the road. In fact, on the residential side of the road, along the northerly side of the road, if it would be the north, as you're going down on the left, the proposal from the design review committee had absolutely no expansion of shoulders on that side, and there was significant opposition. So, you know, it's very difficult to estimate the cost of putting on a total of 4 foot in shoulders when, you know, it's really unclear to me where it would go based on the discussion that the council had at the previous meeting.
I have a few comments and a few questions. First, Mr. McGovern, I take it so the public is informed that when you went to Augusta, you were informed by MDOT officials that they would not fund a bike path unless it was 4 foot on each side. Is that correct?
That's correct.
All right. Now, these monies, you then had a discussion with state officials that these monies might be available for other projects, but as a precursor to that, would we need to, this town council, vote the bike path down first before those funds would be freed up?
That would be the nexus. Defeat the Two Lights design review, proposed report, say we don't want the bikeway funds, then those funds would be transferred to wherever you desire.
So Councillor Berry's motion, at this point in time, there are no funds available from any of these projects until, as a precursor, we would, as a town, first refuse that money on the grant that we have been approved for to build the bike path.
Yes, I think that's understood to be part of Councillor Berry's motion, even though it might not have been expressly stated.
But there has been no vote on turning down the bike path, and thus there would be no legal document and nothing anybody could point to that we had ever refused those funds. So that would have to be done first, would it not?
I would, through the course of this meeting, work to ensure that the minutes were clear and the council record was clear, so that if I did anything in response to the council, it was clearly with the council's authority.
It would not be that difficult to have a vote on the motion that was tabled.
That's what I'm suggesting. At this point in time, Councilor Berry, or anyone, is there a motion to table Councilor Berry's motion until we first vote on whether to accept the money for the bike path or not? Because the way I understand it, that's a condition precedent before we could vote on any other use of those funds.
That's not the way it's laid out here.
I'm not so sure that's necessary. I think we're authorizing the town manager to follow our direction and request that these funds be allocated in the way that we've recommended.
That was my intent.
Well, let me ask the town manager. Were your discussions with the state premised on the fact that there was a vote withdrawing the application for the bike path, or was it, can we just merrily have these funds sitting at the state and without turning down the bike path, the reason we're eligible for these funds, simply allocate these funds wherever we want?
Let me answer it in the way that it fits the state and PAC's policy. If funds are transferred from one project to another, it must be on the condition that the earlier project has either been finished with sufficient funds or it's being abandoned. If it's being abandoned, which is the conjecture with option two, PACS, the Regional Transportation Priority Center, provides that the project cannot return to the process for at least two biennial, or 4 years.
So where is the record and the vote of the town council that we have abandoned this project?
It's not yet in the record.
Well, how can we allocate funds to another use until this project has been abandoned?
Well, I would assume that when Councilor Berry's motion comes up for final vote, it would perhaps be amended to make that clear that was a preface to the motion.
Well, I will make that amendment as a preface if that will make it clearer.
Could we then hear the motion, Councilor Berry?
To authorize the town manager to request PACS and MDOT to fund $80,000 for drainage improvements and paving on Two Lights Road, and to move the balance of the Two Lights project money to be allocated to the town center sidewalk drainage project, and not to proceed with the larger bikeway project.
Is that
acceptable?
Second? I have one other comment. If, in fact, we were to spend any money on Two Lights Road in accord with this proposal, is it true or not true that the argument would then be that we would never again be able to have the state assist us in the upkeep of that road, and it would be then turned over to totally local control?
It would be anyway.
It is the understanding of the state of Maine, Maine Department of Transportation, that if a project was funded, i.e. the $80,000 of drainage improvements and paving, that section would then become state responsibility, would become local responsibility. There already is a section that is local responsibility of this section, which extends from approximately the Poulin residence to the Cambridge residence. So there already is a section in the middle that is town, but this would make the balance of it come to municipal responsibility.
And it would come to municipal responsibility with basically no improvement whatsoever in the roadbed, no shoulders of any kind, and is there any estimate of the useful life of that that road as thus improved, as proposed?
The roadbed itself would not be improved, but you know the roadbed itself is not that poor. The drainage would be an improvement by putting in additional fingers into that section by the strawberry field. It's not a cure-all. The shoulders would be improved with gravel, whereas now they kind of, the road tends to break off at the end because of insufficient gravel. The useful life of any paved road, usually before it needs to be paved again, is in the range of 12 to 15 years, depending on if sewers went in it, if there were a lot of excavations, that type of an issue. But we could expect to get about 12 years out of it.
Of the roadbed and then whatever, the gravel shoulders, who knows?
Now the gravel shoulders, stay pretty much in place unless there's a real bad washout, but they generally stay in place.
And the town center project, for many of the councilors who were not on the council when the town center project was discussed in detail, if this money was allocated totally to the town center project, would we then be able to have in the town the series of sidewalks to serve the high school that has been impossible to fund so far?
Probably the next phase that we would do is to put a sidewalk between Fowler Road and the high school entrance, if there were additional available funds.
Which is in part the part of the project that the last council felt was necessary from a safety point of view, but simply did not have the funds available in the Town Center project to do that. Is that correct?
That's my understanding of the prior council's position.
So what we would be doing, in part, if we spent this money on an overlay of two lights with no bike path and basically an overlay like any road, is we would be taking the money and using it there, and one at least could argue that the safety concerns of the completion of the Town Center project would once again be put aside. Is that correct?
Put aside?
That's more of a policy question than an administrative one, and I will defer.
You can beg off on that.
Thank you.
Councilor Jordan.
I don't want to get involved with the legal beagles here, but I think for the people of the town, we should vote on item 63, and then we should, if we're in agreement with item, with two option, number two option, that we should have 63B or 63A.
Well, I think you have to talk Councilor Berry into that, and there's a motion pending on the table, and we could do that, but there's a motion right now pending.
I understand there's a motion right now.
Now, if Councilor Berry would...
This is a thought that you people should think about. The proper way to do it, in my opinion, is to let the people know how you vote on item 63, and then if you want to take up option two in the manager's memo has been presented, you can call for a special item as item 63B.
And just so the people at home understand, item 63 is the action upon recommendation from the Two Lights Design Review Committee for the recommended design of Two Lights Bikeway / pedestrian path. And I take it, Councilor Jordan, that's what you're referring to, and the fact that that was the motion that was tabled, and that there has never been a vote on that particular motion.
And that's the one that was brought from the table.
Well, is there anybody who would like to raise a point of order that this was, in fact, the motion that was tabled, and that is the motion that has been brought back and would, I believe, have precedence over any other motion?
That's fine with me.
I would.
All right. Is there a motion on item 63?
I will, again, make my motion as it was written. Do you want me to read that?
I think that would be appropriate.
Ordered, whereas the acceptance of funding to construct 2 4-foot-wide bicycle and pedestrian paths adjacent to Two Lights Road in Cape Elizabeth under the specific provisions of the federal ICE-T program does not allow adequate flexibility to address specific safety problems on Two Lights Road without losing the road's rural character. Therefore, the Cape Elizabeth Town Council does hereby direct the town manager to inform the Maine Department of Transportation in writing that the town will not be moving forward with the proposed Two Lights Bike Path project, and that the state and federal share of the project will not be used for the proposed project of the town of Cape Elizabeth.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Discussion on that motion. Councilor Reed.
Just a statement that since that item was brought up last month, that the town council has received 28 letters in addition to the information we had last time in our packet of support of members of the community for this project.
Further discussion? Hearing none, have a vote, a roll call vote.
On the motion by Councilor Fritz, Councilor Berry?
Yes.
Councilor Beyer?
No.
Councilor Fritz?
Yes.
Councilor Jordan?
Yes.
Councilor McGinty?
Yes.
Councilor Reed?
No.
Chairman Groff?
No.
4-3.
It's 4-3. The motion passes. Now I believe that Councilor Berry had made a motion that was seconded. That motion is now on the floor. Is there further discussion concerning Councilor Berry's motion? Councilor McGinty.
I have a couple more questions for the town manager. You said that if we pave Two Lights Road, then we're going to accept it as a town road.
We would accept the balance of the section between Route 77 and Two Light State Park that are not already town responsibility.
What if we only, you know, my major concern here is the safety, particularly around the hill, the hills and the, and,
right,
the curve there. What if we only used $80,000 from approximately Hannaford Cove out towards the state park? Would we then just accept responsibility for that part of the road? I have a real concern about the drainage issue, because that is currently a state responsibility. And according to the engineers who were here previously, they said that it's cost prohibitive to fix the problem. Like, obviously it could be done, but it's very expensive to do. They can mitigate the problem, but they can't fix it. And I'm concerned that if we accept responsibility for that drainage problem, then we could end up spending big bucks of our own money to fix that if somebody wanted to push the issue. And so that is a concern of mine. I'd rather see us use the $80,000 to simply address the safety issue for pedestrians and bicyclists. And I guess I'm asking if that's possible to do.
You're asking the town manager?
I'm asking the town manager.
If there is a design, if we have currently have a design to accomplish that?
Not if we currently have a design.
Or we can spend the money in some way that we have not yet formulated to do that.
Well, we have a design. What we need to look at is from Hannaford Cove and not make it 4 feet wide, I guess is what I'm saying. I don't know how much that would cost.
But that's not quite right, because the design that we have does not entail simply adding to each side.
Okay,
the design is much more complicated than that, and nobody could ever conceive.
All right, just to pave and do shoulder work then, if that makes sense, okay? That's what I'm talking about. Can we just do it from that portion and then accept responsibility for that portion of the road?
I can't speak for the state, since that issue was not specifically addressed to them.
Is there any time, let me ask the town manager, is there any time concern here? Does this item have to be acted on tonight to be able to stay in some type of priority with these funds with the state?
No, it does not.
What happened to the light?
Excuse me?
The light money? It went away because the town council didn't act and you weren't asked in advance if you wanted it to go away. It just went.
Yeah, I would assume that when the council chairman asked me that question, it was with the assumption that the council would be soon revisiting this issue. You weren't supposing that would be putting it off for 3 to 6 months. You were looking within the next month or two. And I would expect the state to have no problem with dealing with us for a month or two on the issue.
That's fine. The reason I did ask is if councilors are thinking that they can take $80,000 and do something with the shoulders, and absolutely nobody sitting up here has any clue what, I think that is not a wise use of anybody's money, including the federal government, the state government, or the town of Cape Elizabeth. And for that reason, I personally would certainly not vote for something that I have no clue if it even can be accomplished.
That plan that we have anticipates 4 foot wide shoulders in that area. That doesn't seem out of the question to reduce it to 2 feet wide in that area, and I don't know how much it will cost, but it isn't an unreasonable request, I think.
The question is, though, with that design did not anticipate simply taking the road and adding some. And the cost was different where you were in that road and which way you wanted to go and how far. And if you can draw an estimate of cost or feasibility from that study, you're a much better quick study in engineering than I could ever be. Councilor Reed.
To restate your comment, Councilor Groff, Chairman Groff, for those who might not understand exactly what the importance of this item is, that design said we were going to move the center of the road to minimize impact on 90% of the impacted people. That is what several people didn't agree with on this council. Now, to suggest that we open up that road to 2 feet on either side is absolutely ludicrous, to put this town through that discussion again, because the same people who objected to no impact are definitely going to object to a 2-foot impact on the side of their road. Thank you.
Councilor Jordan.
Well, I just wanted to say that if they could move the center of the road to the west a little bit down through the open field, to put 4 feet on each side without disturbing the houses, I should think they could do it enough to get 2 feet on each side or something like that. It still could be done, and I think we're at a point that somebody's got to take a look at it and give us an estimate on the cost of it.
Is there any other discussion? Councilor Byer?
Well, I just make a comment. I complimented the committee who spent, I've forgotten how many meetings, but a lot of meetings and time and energy. I think they did a good job, and I think it's very presumptuous of us to sit up here and redo their job without even having spent the time to look. I mean, if we want to send somebody off to make a new study, that's one issue, but I don't think we can determine it here tonight. That would be, in my opinion, a big mistake.
Any other comment? Councilor McGinty.
You know, I'm tired of agonizing over this thing, and I have agonized over it. On any other project, we'd go to Bob Malley and we'd say, what would it take to pave the road, do shoulder improvements, come back, let us know what it would take. I see no reason why we shouldn't do it with this particular location. Go to our own professionals here in town and say, what's it going to take to do this? And let him do what he does on any other road that doesn't involve some massive study like this. And let's move this forward.
I agree.
Well, my problem is that, and you know, we can certainly do whatever the council wants. We're talking about $80,000, and I don't really understand what we could get for $80,000 at this point in time.
I don't know either, but if it's going to take $100,000, I'm willing to kick in the other $20,000 if that's what it's going to take. I don't know either, but we're not going to decide that tonight, Mr. Chairman. I think we should throw it in Bob Malley's field and let him tell us exactly what he can give us for $80,000, or if it's going to take an extra $10,000 or $20,000, and we'll go from there.
Obviously, the other option tonight is to sit there and spend some time in the next 30 days without voting how to request Mr. McGovern to go to the state and ask. And that's what all we're doing right now, is asking our town manager to go to the state and ask if we can spend the money in some other way. And there's no absolute guarantee. And I would suggest one of the other options, when you look at the totality of the circumstance and talk about us perhaps then being stuck with Two Lights Road in the sense with a minimal repair job and then stuck with the road and maybe the drainage issues also, that we should also be weighing spending that money in the town center when in fact we know exactly what we're getting. And that project has gone forward. And I am suggesting that out of frustration and the fact that a large portion of the town perhaps believes that there was an inappropriate vote of this council and a portion believes that there was an appropriate vote, a Band-Aid compromise remedy is perhaps not the best remedy, although it might seem politically expedient at the moment. And that's why I'm going to vote against this particular motion and ask that the town manager, if this motion is defeated, ask that the town manager consider the comments of the council tonight and at the next meeting, scheduled meeting of the town council, have further discussion with the state and bring to this council some firmer recommendations as to what this money would accomplish either on this road or in the town center project, and would also give the councilors who really haven't been exposed to the town center project an opportunity to further educate themselves. Is there other discussion?
I have a question to go back to the town manager again, just to make sure I understand the dollars and cents. If we were to defeat the current motion, and instead pass item number three, and perhaps do it with a caveat that the light not be included initially, would that not give us enough money to go ahead with state approval on the town center project, and then have enough still open for a study between now and next month to look into whether number two takes its $80,000 and has a little slush fund with a headlight, the stoplight? Am I missing something here?
I don't think you're missing anything, but I would much prefer that we not make half a decision, that whenever I approach the state, it's clear that exactly where the council stands and all the different issues that I'm to go to Augusta and represent.
Thank you.
Do we have a motion on the floor?
There is a motion on the floor. Councilor Barry's motion is on the floor. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none, I'll ask for a roll call vote.
Councilor Barry?
Yes.
Councilor Breyer?
No.
Councilor Fritz?
No.
Councilor Jordan?
No.
Councilor McGinty?
Yes.
Councilor Reed?
No.
Chairman Groff?
No.
2-5.
Motion is defeated 2-5.
I'd like to move the town council request the town manager to obtain cost estimates for providing paving on Two Lights Road to include 2-foot wide paved shoulders from Hannaford Cove Road easterly to the State Park entrance.
Second.
Discussion. Is this motion contemplate that there are any funds allocated for this, or are you just simply directing the town manager to talk to town staff?
With the intent that information be used to explore whether PAX and MainDOT would be able to fund improvements to the road, allowing with the remainder of the money allocated to the town center sidewalk drainage project.
That's in addition to the motion? Is that acceptable to the second?
Yes.
Does that contemplate discussion? Does that contemplate the town manager following any particular design of any kind in obtaining these cost estimates?
Repaving the road with 2-foot shoulders from Hannaford Cove to the State Park entrance, easterly to the State Park entrance.
The 2-foot on each side of the road, or?
Side?
On each side.
Each side of the road, not as in the original design where the center path was there and the road designed to minimize impact upon neighbors.
I'll agree to use the center line as proposed in the design of the original bike path.
Is there discussion on the motion? Councilor Jordan.
I have a problem with that, because I think at the same time that hill there by Hannah's just beyond Hanford Cove Road should be looked at pretty hard and be taken down and built up in the lower area so you don't have so much of a dip to come up over. If you're thinking of the long-term deal, I think that should be looked at.
Other discussion? Councilor Beyer.
Yeah, I apologize. I haven't thought this through very well, so I'll probably muddle it a little bit. But it seems to me, if I'm doing my math correctly, we're now proposing to create a half of a half of a bike path. It's half as wide, and it's certainly half as long, or whatever. It doesn't go from anywhere to anywhere in particular. And I guess I'm frustrated by The fact that we had the study, did the study, and if the answer's no, let's say no, but I'm not sure that this is accomplishing very much.
Counselor Reed.
I concur with Counselor Beyer. It's a half of a half, that you have to be halfway there before you start to use the safe bikeway, and I'm concerned that it does not address the issues that the Design Review Committee spent so much time deliberating on, and I'm not voting to support this.
Other discussion?
I'll have my comments. This, to me, is simply a politically expedient gesture that has no value. It's a waste of the town's money, and that money could much better be used for other avenues. And in also the long-run, all long-term ramifications of spending money in this way, I really do not yet understand in the sense of whether the state is then relieved, what the state is then relieved of concerning their responsibilities of this road. And I think any action in this regard would be detrimental to the town's long-term interest. I will vote against it. Other discussion?
May I ask Councilor Jordan if he would be interested in having an estimate on the hill included in the motion?
I think you should have an estimate. You should have a figure of what would happen there, and before we even vote for the issue. I'd like to know what it's going to cost to do the job.
I'd like to include in my motion to have the Hannah's Hill area evaluated as well.
All right. Since we've had, that's an amendment to the motion, and I take it it's accepted by the individual seconded or not?
Yeah.
Could we now have the entire, since it's been right. amended twice, I would like to have the totality of the motion that we're voting on read. To the best of the town manager's ability.
Clerk pro tem tonight.
Clerk pro tem.
It was moved by Councilor Fritz and seconded by Councilor Berry to request the town manager to obtain cost estimates to provide paving on Two Lights Road with 2-foot wide paved shoulders from Hannaford Cove Road easterly to Two Lights State Park with the intent to explore if PACS and MDOT would fund this with the remainder of the money to go to the Town Center project and to add Hannah's Hill to the consideration.
And there's nothing about...
And using the center line as proposed by the bike path study.
So this is the whole road? Paving,
no.
Well, the way he just read it was paving the whole road. Shoulders only a portion, but paving the whole road. That's what he just read. I just want to make, that's why I'm asking him to read it.
No, that's the 2-foot wide paved shoulders simply from Hannaford Cove Road easterly to Two Lights State Park.
And then
paving only that section was my understanding of the
paving just that portion of the road?
Just from Hannaford to Two Lights State Park.
Right.
So that would be
and leaving the drainage issue still that portion of the road with the state.
Do we know, Mr. McGovern, if in fact the state would buy that and take the position that the draining issue, if we improve that part of the road, have improved another, whether the state, what position the state would take as to whose issue the drainage problem is?
We do not.
Any other discussion?
Just one quick point, if I might. The Hannah's Hill project is not a small project. It's very complicated. We went out and looked at it. It involves a major grade change. It would extend, from the equivalent that you'd be needing to change the grade of the road from where we're sitting over to the fire station, roughly. We're talking a project in the hundreds of thousands of dollars. And to obtain a cost estimate on that is not one that's within the capability of our staff in-house. We would have to expend funds using an engineer to develop a cost estimate. That would be a very major project. It also involves wetlands on the state-owned side of the property. to the southeast, and I just, you know, want to caution the council that if this motion were to pass, it would require the expenditure of some local funds in order to develop that cost estimate, and you are looking at a project in the hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Well, one last comment before we vote. We just spent $35,000 and tons of people's time to design a bike path, and now we're voting on having the town manager using town resources, just town resources, on an ad hoc basis for our next meeting to come up with a design and cost estimates on a portion of what people have spent literally years trying to do, and now we've thrown in Hannes Hill also. I mean, we're at the level of the absolute absurd. Is there any other discussion?
I'll remove, in light of the possible expense, they're going to an engineer in order to get estimates for Hannes Hill. I'll take out Hannes Hill and just have it be the 2-foot wide pavement.
Does the seconder accept that amendment?
For purposes of discussion, yeah.
Well, we're. Do you have further discussion, Councilor Barry?
No.
Well, then, for purposes not just of discussion, for purposes of the vote, correct?
Go ahead.
Okay. Any other discussion? There has to be a roll call vote on the motion, as amended 4 times.
Councilor Barry?
No.
Councilor Beyer?
No.
Councilor Fritz?
Yes.
Councilor Jordan?
No.
Councilor McGinty?
Yes.
Councilor Reed?
No.
Chairman Groff?
No.
2-5.
Motion's defeated 2-5. Are there any other motions that anyone would care to make concerning
item 63.
What the town manager should or should not do vis-a-vis the state in concerning these monies that we've been talking about?
Could I ask a question?
Certainly.
Of the town manager, you've presented 4 choices or options as they're designated in our packet here. And it seemed to me that that the second one was a proposal that the state would go along with. Is that right?
That's correct.
Yeah, that's what I thought. And that you had some definite idea in mind of doing drainage improvements and paving for this money that would improve the Two Lights Road and the safety conditions there. Is that what you had in mind and the state is approving?
Yes, Councilor Barry. The issue was that there isn't the best pavement condition there. The shoulder is sort of breaking off. The gravel shoulders aren't as good as they should be. The drainage could be improved somewhat, not a pure resolution. And that rather than wait for some unknown date for the state to sometime come in and fix this road, that the citizens of Cape Elizabeth might be better served by going in there, doing it now, doing it with the 80% federal money, 20% local money, and then all the visitors to the state park, the residents down there, and others who travel Two Lights Road would have a good road to travel on with some improved drainage.
And you feel that the $80,000 could take care of this?
That's exactly right. To pave the road exactly in its current configuration with an overlay.
And perhaps add to the shoulders a little?
Just to enhance the gravel shoulders, yeah, where the gravel shoulders now exist. We wouldn't be creating a shoulder in areas where there's people's lawns now exist.
All right.
Councilor Reed.
Chairman Groff, may I please make a motion, since we've eliminated number 1, 2, and 4 from the 4 options that were given to us to consider?
There are no motions currently pending.
I'd like to authorize that the town manager request PACS and MDOT to move all of the Two Lights project fund in the amount of $261,500 to the Town Center Sidewalk Drainage Project.
Is there a second?
Second.
Councilor Byer seconds it. Discussion. Councilor McGinty.
I can't support that motion. I'd like to see some safety enhancements on Two Lights Road.
Right.
Me too.
Agree.
Well, then why don't we take the $80,000 and do it?
Exactly.
That's, could we go through the chair, please? Councilor Byer.
Two things. First of all, I'd like to be enlightened in regard to the merits of the traffic light, which I understand is included in that Town Center plan, as to how necessary it is and why, since I have an inherent dislike for traffic lights. And I would, I think, I guess I'll ask a question as well at the same time that I have the opportunity. The money, Mike, that's taken for this, if I go back to my money understanding question at the very beginning, does not necessarily mean that we have taken the potential $80,000 away from being spent somewhere else. Should that come up at a later vote or some later motion? Is that correct? In an acceptable way to the majority of the council?
If this motion passed and was not revisited this evening in some fashion,
it would be gone.
It would be very, yeah, all of the monies will have been transferred to the Town Center project pending PACs and MDOT approval. It'd be very difficult, and you know, I would quite frankly be embarrassed to go back to those agencies and ask for another transfer.
But adding up your dollars, there is theoretically $80,000 left over after, if we vote for number three to approve the Town Center, that might be used in some fashion somewhere else if we voted tonight. Is that what you're saying?
No, there really wouldn't be, because Rosemary Reed's motion was to transfer the entire balance.
Okay.
And under the PACS policy, you could only transfer funds to the projects that I described at the beginning, ones that were under budget and hadn't been funded. You just couldn't transfer it wherever you wanted in town.
Okay, thank you.
But, you know, if this motion were to pass, you know, it would be with my assumption that, you know, I've heard a lot of issues about the traffic light, that, you know, we would spend some time on that, you know, at another time, that you'd actually review this whole design, of which this would be one component of it. You know, there are some issues Councilor Jordan's raised in the past about how wide would an esplanade be, how many trees would go in, that type of thing. And, you know, what I would like to do is have the council, if this moves forward, to serve as the design review committee in the end to approve the design because of, you know, the circumstances and the difficulty we've had with outside design review committees. As for the justification of the traffic light, that first came up at the request of the town council back in probably the mid-1980s. It was subsequently funded by the state in about 1991. Many planning board actions since that time have been predicated on the fact that there would be a traffic light at that intersection. For example, the construction of the Crescent House was based on a traffic study that provided that. I believe the Cumberland Farms site by itself, when that site plan last occurred, was predicated on that. The community center driveway was predicated on that. The high school, middle school, elementary school renovation project, all of that traffic was sent down Scott Dyer Road since that traffic light was first approved. The community care matrix building that's due to go on Scott Dyer Road with construction beginning sometime in the near future was predicated on that traffic light by the planning board being there. The Dominicus Crossing subdivision coming out of Wells Road, and that traffic was predicated on that traffic light. In addition to all of those actions, we also do receive a substantial number of phone calls, particularly from elderly residents, complaining that they can't get across the street to go to the bank. And there's a real strong desire that to be by many of elderly citizens who have contacted us that they would like a better way of getting across the street. Finally, I should mention the Town Center Committee, when they reviewed this issue, there was some division within that group, and they ended up writing a letter taking no action at all on whether or not there ought to be a traffic light there or not.
Thank you.
Further discussion on the pending motion?
I think I intend to vote against this motion and would like to go back and consider number two.
Counselor Jordan.
I'm kind of against this motion, too, and I would like to also go back to two. The only problem I had with two when I voted before is there was no paved shoulders involved there, and I think that should be looked at. Any road that's repaved within the town from now on should be really considered about a paved walkway, bikeway, and they can plow snow out onto them just as well as they can plow it out onto grass.
Any other discussion? Hearing no further discussion, vote on the motion. Roll call vote.
Counselor Barry?
No.
Counselor Beyer?
Yes.
Counselor Fritz?
No.
Counselor Jordan?
No.
Counselor McGinty?
No.
Counselor Reed?
Yes.
Chairman Groff?
Yes.
3-4.
The motion is defeated, 3-4.
I'd like to move to reconsider number two, to authorize the town manager to request PACS and MainDOT to fund $80,000 for drainage improvements and paving on Two Lights Road, and to move the balance of the Two Lights Road project money to be allocated to the town center sidewalk drainage project.
Second the motion.
Discussion. Counselor Reed.
That motion was made for just exactly what it was said, with no implied anything else, right?
Well, all I can go by is the verbiage of the motion.
I'm just trying to conceptualize here.
Why don't you ask Mike to repeat it?
And Mike, would you please?
It was moved to authorize the town manager to request PACS and MDOT to fund $80,000 for drainage improvements and paving on Two Lights Road, and to move the balance of the Two Lights project money to the town center sidewalk drainage project.
Mr. Chair.
Councilor McGinty.
Could we make an assumption that the town manager will explore a lot of those questions that we had about who the road will go back to and the drainage issue can...
I think once you do it, you do it. Once you... we can do that, but once you move the money and do the project, you buy the problems. And that's... I think that's the discussion we had before.
Well, I guess I you said you weren't certain what the ramifications of that were, and I think what we need to do is find out what, in his discussions with MDOT, to find out exactly what that means.
No, I think what I asked about was the discussions before of doing part of the road, what happens to the part of the road we don't do. I never heard any equivocation on once we start to take the $80,000 and plow it into fixing that drainage issue that we don't buy the problem. Unless, and if that's not right, please tell us.
The understanding with MDOT is if this road was paved and the drainage improvements were made, that this section of road, instead of being partially a town responsibility, would be totally a town responsibility.
It's for that reason that I will not vote for this, because I was willing to have the town take over this road with a major expenditure on this road, with 4-foot bike paths, with this road safe and fixed. I'm not willing to vote for the town plowing some fix-it-up money into this road, then accepting the drainage problems, accepting the unsafe road, and having it be future council's problems. We had a chance to fix it with funds. We voted not to do it, and a Band-Aid won't do it. We're better off spending the money on something else and then dealing with the state on this road where it's the state's responsibility.
I don't agree.
Any other discussion? Hearing no further discussion.
Mr. Chairman, I think it's a good compromise.
Any further discussion?
Hearing none. Roll call vote, please.
Councilor Berry.
Yes.
Councilor Byer.
No.
Councilor Fritz.
Yes.
Councilor Jordan.
Yes.
Councilor McGinty.
Yes.
Councilor Reed.
No.
Councilor Graff.
No.
4-3.
Carries 4-3. The next item is item 78, action upon annual liquor licenses for Susan Leg T Leg Events, Fort Fairfield Yacht Club at the Inn by the Sea. Is there a motion?
I move approval of the application.
Second it.
All in favor? 7-0. Item 79, action upon appointments committee recommended candidates for boards and commissions. Councilor Reed.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, thank you very much. We were privileged again this year to have numerous applicants for our boards and commissions. We are reserving the filling of the recycling committee and the conservation commission openings until the next meeting. However, I'm happy to announce that we're nominating for the Arts Commission Ashley Warner Collins, Marsha Wiggins, Don Evans, for Assessment Review, David Griffin, for Family Fun Day, excuse me, we do have one appointment, Marion Tizon, Emily Scotton as a reappointment. The Fort Williams Advisory Commission is Glenn Israel. Nancy Sears is a reappointment. For the Personnel Appeals Board, Ann Chapman. For the Planning Board, we're reappointing Steve Parkhurst. We're appointing Nancy Masterton and David Griffin. For the Riverside Cemetery Trustees, Wayne Brooking. For the Thomas Memorial Library Trustees, reappointing Judy Simons, Catherine Kaczynski, and for the Zoning Board of Appeals, reappointment of Elizabeth Monahan and appointment of Robert Cronin. Those are our standing committees. We also have appointments to the Telecommunications Facilities Committee. Would you like those named at the same time?
That would be fine.
Robert Howe, Lawrence Clough, Don Barrett, Thomas Parada, and Peter Carter. I'm sorry, those last two names are incorrect.
Those last two names, through the chairman, Mr. LaPrade is a member of the Zoning Board,
right.
The Zoning Board's recommendation.
Right.
And Peter Carter is the Planning Board rep.
Thank you. And they've already been approved for those positions. And
so we also need to appoint a counselor to the Telecommunications Facilities. Yeah, is there a counselor with an interest in learning a lot more about this issue that's going to be at the forefront, perhaps?
I'll take a shot at it. Seems a towel might fall on my property if it come down.
Councilor Jordan.
Mr. Chair, I just have one question. The Cable Television Committee, was there an appointment there? I think you maybe missed that name. No?
Reappointment.
Ann
a reappointment
Ridge.
Of
okay.
Ann Ridge. I'm sorry, that
okay.
was a reappointment. Right. Thank you, John.
And I take it that's in the form now of a motion to approve these appointments?
Yes, please.
Second. Second.
Second by Councilor Byer. Discussion at all? Councilor Byer?
Yes, I'd just like to make a comment that Councilors Reed, Berry, and I interviewed almost all of these folks, and it's very nice that we have so many excellent people who come forward to volunteer. And thank you to all of them, and I'd encourage others of you to come up when you get a chance. It's a nice thing about this town.
I'd like to join in those remarks as another member of the committee.
And as the chair and on this committee last year, you can't not help but be impressed
right.
when you sit and you interview people that want to serve this town.
Right.
And this is the people on this list, each and every person in their own right, is a very good citizen. All in favor of the
the appointments as set forth by the Appointments Committee. Opposed? Passed 7-0. Item 80. Action upon request from Greater Portland Development Group to accept Jordan Farm Road. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. With the council's indulgence, I'd like to also discuss item number 81 at the same time, which affects this issue as well.
Why don't we read 81 so people at home could... Item 81 is action to refer to Planning Board proposed amendment to the subdivision ordinance, which would permit the Planning Board to waive a requirement that there be sidewalks on all roads in new subdivisions.
Thank you. The this item of Jordan Farm Road goes back to around 1968, according to the records that I have. The town long sought another way out of Broad Cove, either an emergency access road only or a regular full paved road. As a result of the what is now known as the Broad Cove Highlands subdivision, there is now a portion of a paved road that extends from Two Lights Road in several hundred, about 500 feet maybe, to a dirt road, and then there's a section that comes in from Winding Way and Running Tide Road at the intersection that extends in as well. All those roads, the paved roads as well as the dirt road in the middle, were ordained by the Planning Board and by the Council several years ago upon their successful construction that they should be accepted by the town. It's kind of rare for a dirt road to be accepted by the town, but that was the way it was approved by the Planning Board, and it was agreed to by the Town Council at the time. And that was because the DEP wouldn't allow it to be paved, and there was strong feeling amongst the residences in that area. We have sent out the inspector to look at the road, and everything is done with the exception of some minor loaming and seeding at a particular residence and along one small section of the emergency access road. There's a sidewalk that's shown on the plan that isn't in, which I'm going to return to in a minute. And there's also one of the conditions the Planning Board passed the last time this came to the Planning Board was a requirement that there be some additional landscaping put in near the Boxer residence that would be according to a plan that the developer would submit and then would be acceptable to the town planner. As this process has been ongoing, as it was constructed, a number of issues have come up. One is that the sidewalk is one that I have not found anyone who believes that there ought to be a sidewalk in this particular location. It's the residences on both sides are strongly opposed to it. The town public works department believes it's a total waste to maintain it because you're going to have a dead-end street with two houses, then a dirt road, and then another dead-end street with two houses. Actually, there's a couple more than two in that particular section. But anyway, it's very, very low traffic volume, and it makes no sense to have a sidewalk. We have an additional issue with Dominica's Crossing that we're going to be building about 2 miles of sidewalks in that subdivision, including on all the little dead-end spurs out of it. And it just doesn't seem to make sense to be incurring public expense for years to come for sidewalks that no one's going to use because the streets are so quiet that everyone's going to walk in the street. So, you know, rather than force Mr. Kennedy to put in the sidewalk that no one wants, it was felt, you know, let's perhaps give the Planning Board the right to waive this in the future, as well as for Mr. Kennedy to go back and to have the opportunity to go to the Planning Board to ask them to waive this particular requirement. Well, how can we do that and still get the road accepted? Because it takes 9 months or more to even get the ordinance amendment with public hearings approved by the council and by the Planning Board. The way to do that would be to set up an escrow agreement that we would actually have the money in hand to do the sidewalk in case it wasn't waived. And in the meantime, you know, we could go forward, accept the road, and at last have this road that we've desperately wanted for so long under town ownership. One additional problem is that with this landscaping that was proposed to be done by the Boxer residents, it was never covered by any letter of credit because of the way it was amended. The earlier letter of credit was for other work to be done. So, you know, it could be argued that there was no way to absolutely require Mr. Kennedy to do that if he really, really put up a big stink about it. And while, you know, he's not apt to do that, perhaps, or actually he may be, It's still, there seemed to be a way that we could win-win-win on this. One is that we would get the road finally at long last. Two would deal with the sidewalk issue, would save his some funds, would be something all the neighbors down there would want. Three, we would have a performance guarantee in place now. Four, the landscaping to be done. So what I'm recommending is, and you have before you this evening, is an escrow agreement. Mr. Kennedy gave me today a certified bank check, actually a bank check from Key Bank, for $6,000. All of the items have a 25% overhead in them, so you know it's not close at all in terms of getting the work done. It provides that the loaming and seeding of the emergency access road and the landscaping would need to be done no later than May 30th. I have a letter from Maureen Saradin, the landscape person who's working with Maureen, that's even looking, weather permitting, at doing it in a very, very short period of time. But I didn't want to put that in the agreement because you never know with the weather. The other items would be done, and if it wasn't done, then we would step in and do it by June 30. So we'd get this all done. I think this is a win-win all the way around, and I would like to encourage the council to approve this escrow agreement. If you notice, there's language in it that says, I've already signed it, but it's null and void, that if you didn't approve it, to accept the balance of Jordan Farm Road. And there's also one small section which has also been completed, which it was totally my error, of Channel View Road, that was part of this phase of Broad Cove, that I also have the letter from the engineer that the inspection, it totally passed with flying colors, except CMP needs to do one minor item, but they already have been given the money from the developer to do it, so it's a non-issue. So, you know, I would urge you to accept the balance of Jordan Farm Road and Channel View Road, as shown on the plan for Broad Cove Highlands, and to approve the escrow agreement.
Is there such a motion? Councilor Reed.
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Discussion? Councilor Reed.
I just had a question. Since Mr. Kennedy's here, and since one of those two households that are on that road that are represented in the audience, where there's a limited opportunity for people to speak, could we ask if either of those people have anything to say?
Well,
maybe not, but I just wanted to.
We could.
Well, I'm asking the chair.
But let's put it this way: I take it the town manager has already indicated that he has spoken with these individuals, and that
I haven't spoken. I think there's a gentleman here who I assume is on the paved portion that's already been accepted. That's where he lives. I haven't spoken to him. I have spoken to the people on the in the portion that's before you for acceptance this evening.
Well, let's do it this way. Is there anybody in the audience that wishes to speak that would be against the council authorizing the agreement that has been signed subject to our approval by the town manager? And if so, just please so indicate and have an opportunity to speak. Please come up to the podium and introduce yourself.
My name is Chris Tainter, and I live at 6 Jordan Farm Road, which is the Two Lights Road paved portion of the road. I'm not vehemently opposed to anything that's going on. One of the things that my neighbors and I have been concerned about, and by my neighbors I refer not only to the people on the paved portion of Jordan Farm Road, but also the people who have built and are building homes on the unpaved portion, or in the lots in the middle between the paved portions, is the possibility that the town may one day want to run that road through in an entirely paved fashion. And we're all concerned about that possibility. When I bought my lot from Peter Kennedy, it was understood, and the subdivision plan upon which we based our decision showed the area immediately in front of my residence as a dead end. I certainly understood, although I understood also that Peter couldn't make any representations to me about what the town may want to do someday in the future. I understood that that would be a dead end, and particularly in view of the fact that Two Lights Road apparently now is not going to be improved from Jordan Farm Road to Route 77. I have some real concerns about the possibility of Jordan Farm Road ever being a through road from Broad Cove out to Two Lights. Mm-hmm. As a result of those concerns, my neighbors and I, and I speak on behalf of some of those neighbors, are interested in the possibility, or at least considering the possibility, of forming an association, and would propose that the council consider not accepting the road, but rather leaving the road in private ownership, which would give the association, should we decide to form one, some control over what happens with regard to the traffic flow. And that's my concern. Unfortunately, I'm a little bit behind the curve here. I've come into this process late in the game. I just learned today from Peter that this event was occurring tonight. And so I'm in the difficult position of asking the council perhaps to defer acting on something that may or may not, on the basis of something that may or may not happen. I'd like to have some opportunity to discuss the matter further with the Blumenthals and the Daleys and various other neighbors. I think the neighbors in Broad Cove at the other end of the dirt road have some of the same concerns. I think some of the people on Two Lights Road who wanted to preserve the rural character of the road have some of the same concerns about making sure that that doesn't become a through road. And I think there may be some way to for the residents to gain some further control over that. And so that's my proposal to the council is that action be deferred to that extent.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Kemp, could I have the town manager first address the statement to the extent that it's contradictory to the idea that the town's been wanting this road for a long time?
Yeah, the town has, since 1968 or earlier, been looking for another way that it can guarantee to get in and out of Broad Cove. There were compromises made along the way. You know, obviously, initially we did want a full paved road. There were compromises along the way that provided it would be emergency access, certainly that there'd be a couple of gates. Those chained gates are now in place. There were compromises made as to the paving. When the final subdivision approval came from Broad Cove Highlands, the town council legally obligated the town to accept the roads once they were built according to specification. That was part of you always have those votes. You know, it's not in the cards, you know, unless you say it, you know, it wasn't built the way the specs required. It's not in the cards simply to change stream to a new stream at this point. You know, I have given assurances. I've given Mr. Kennedy letters that he's used in marketing purposes, indicating the town's position that as long as I'm here, I will never make a move to get the road paved, that we already fought that battle, we lost it, and, you know, I just won't make that move. So, you know, I've stated again publicly, which I don't know if I ever have, but I have put it in writing, because I think it was important that everyone know the rules. Everyone did know the rules. They should have, you know, discovered them along the way if they didn't, and I would urge the council to honor the legal commitment that the previous council made to accept this section of Jordan Farm Road upon its satisfactory completion.
Councilor McGinty?
I think you pretty much answered most of my questions. Just backing up what you said, the prior council, whatever, had made an obligation to accept this, paved portion of Jordan Farm Road, is that what? The paved portion and the dirt portion. And the dirt. It was very unusual. We don't usually accept dirt roads, but you know, the overriding public safety interests, it was strongly felt the town ought to protect the ability to always maintain a second emergency access out of Broad Cove, a neighborhood with about 300 homes now, that only has one way in, one way out, and you know, you get a tree fall, you have whatever. We want to be able to ensure that there is a regularly maintained accessway in and out of that neighborhood.
Counselor Fritz.
When it is not used for emergency purposes, as long as there are no trees down or anything like that, there is a chain across the road so that there's not traffic normally going back and forth?
There is one other. During the construction of the last phase of Broad Cove Highlands, one of the conditions of the planning board was that all of the construction traffic needed to come in that road because of the people on Broad Cove Road had endured, you know, decades of traffic in and out, building sewers and houses and whatever. And when this subdivision was approved, they said they had to come in that road. So it was open during the construction period. And there is another period when it's sometimes open and left open, but I don't know if I want to publicly, I can whisper it to you, but if I publicly state it, there's going to be more traffic going up and down during those times. So, but there is a time when it's kept open, and I think the people on the road understand when that time is.
But the idea is that it'd
be regularly closed.
Yeah.
So other discussion? Councilor Jordan.
Yes, I just want to say that I'm in agreement at this point to leave it graveled, but I think someday, I may not live to see it, but maybe some of you will, that is going to be a paved road through, and it really, in my opinion, it should be a paved road through for safety factors. There's going to be a certain time of year you can't get through because of what I call a mud season. But nowadays, they don't know what mud season is, but it used to be around years ago. And this memo here of waiving the sidewalk deal. Here we've been arguing all evening whether it's a bikeway or a sidewalk, and people can walk on it or ride a bike on it. Now they want to have a provision to delete them sidewalks. So if you're thinking of the future, I think we'd better build a sidewalk, but I will work on that with the Ordinance Committee. Thank you.
Other discussion?
Is it proposed that this will then open the road to Broad Cove?
Emergency road.
This is an emergency road that's partly paved, and at times it's closed, at times it's opened. The only thing in front of the council at this point in time is the proposal signed by Mr. McGovern and whether to accept that proposal or whether Mr. McGovern's signature is null and void.
The motion, as I understood it, Mr. Chairman, was to accept the unaccepted portions of Jordan Farm Road and Channel View Road as shown on the Broad Cove Highlands plan and to authorize me to sign that escrow agreement. That was the motion Councilor Reed made.
That's fine. Any other discussion? Hearing none. All in favor? Opposed? 7-0 in favor. Item 81, action to refer to Planning Board proposed amendment to the subdivision ordinance which will permit the Planning Board to waive a requirement that there be sidewalks on all roads in new subdivisions. Mr. McGovern has previously given an introductory statement. Is there a motion? Councilor Reed.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we refer this item to the Planning Board.
Second it.
Discussion?
Question. Process question. Goes to the Planning Board, then comes back. They recommend back to us, and then we take final action. Is that?
No, then you'd probably refer it back to the Ordinance Committee.
The Ordinance came back from.
Okay. All right.
Any other discussion? Call the motion. All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Passed. Action item number 82, action upon recommended amendments to the town personnel code relating to insurance benefits. Mr. McGovern.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. The town council has had extensive discussions this past year on what health insurance benefits ought to be provided to both our union as well as our non-union employees. The proposal before you this evening would revise, effective January 1, 1998, the health insurance coverage provided to our employees that are non-union. Currently, employees who receive single coverage have 95% of their premium paid, and employees who receive different dependent coverages also have 95%. With the proposal before you this evening is that we would pay 100% of the cost of the premium for those who choose to take single coverage. Those could be married employees, they could be employees with dependents who are unmarried, or they could be single employees. If they choose the single coverage option, they would get 100% of the cost paid. If they choose an option that includes covering dependents or spouses, the town would pay 90% of the premium cost effective January 1. Beginning in 1999, 50% of any cost increase would be borne by the town and 50% by the employee. However, the employee share would not fall below 80%. Also, a provision here is that if an employee was eligible for coverage that is more expensive than single coverage, if they have dependents and they opt to go to single coverage, they would split any of the savings 50-50 with the town. Also, if there was an employee also could opt out of a health insurance altogether, provided they showed us that they were covered somewhere else, and that cost would also be shared 50-50 by the town. There's also standard language in here in terms of if there was a lifestyle change for the employee, those that are prescribed by the federal government, they could change the package they have. And we would also, effective January 1, begin to offer a Section 125 cafeteria plan that would include a medical expense reimbursement account, which could go up to $2,000 per year. This is the employee's own money being used to be able to pay for medical expenses that would then be lower their federal and state tax income.
Just so we stop for a second, what we're talking about in the cafeteria plan, the way I understand it, is that people would be paying with pre-tax dollars. In other words, the amount that they're using to fund non-covered medical cost and or their copay, they would be paying with gross dollars, not net after tax dollars, which would provide for many of our employees a substantial savings. Is that correct?
That's correct, sir. And the same thing for dependent care reimbursement coverage, which could go up to $5,000 per calendar year per family. So what you have before you is the technical amendment which accomplishes this. You also have the various documents, the boilerplate that the Main Choice, who would be our provider of the Section 125 plan, produces for us, that actually provides the legal language of the cafeteria plan, the medical reimbursement plan, and the dependent care plan. This has been reviewed with the Personnel Advisory Committee, with department heads representing non-union employees, or not necessarily representing, but as non-union employees. Some of them aren't too thrilled about it. Obviously, when you change health insurance coverage, that is likely, but overall, I think it's a very fair plan and one that gives employees a lot more options than they now have.
Is there a motion?
So move.
Second? Councilor Reed?
Chairman.
In that position. Discussion.
Discussion. I had a question. As I understand, a single person, an employee who is a single person, will get 100% of his premium paid for health insurance coverage. A person who is an employee who has dependents will have to pay 10%, that he will get 90% only. And so, including the price for the employee himself, he will have to pay 10% for his own coverage, where the single employee has to pay nothing because he gets 100% coverage. Is that wrong?
Yeah.
Is that right?
You're correct, sir, in one respect. It's not so much based on marital status or dependency status, but anyone who chooses single coverage, they do have that choice, right, would have 100% of the cost paid. If they choose another coverage level with dependents or with just spouse, it would be 90% of the total cost. In reality, that equates to 100% of the single cost plus about $245 per month for that employee. So for those that choose the 90% coverage rather than the 100% coverage, they're getting a benefit that's worth $245 more than the single coverage benefit.
And that's
my thought, that was that the portion of the premium which applies to the person with dependents, that portion of that premium, which it goes for the employee himself, it might seem unequal for the single person to have that portion paid 100% for the single person and only 90% for the other employee who has dependents. But I understand about your
point. Or it could be, Counselor, it could be considered the other way, that right now, if you left at 95% for single people who choose single coverage and 95% for those who have family coverage,
right. The
single person, and I don't mean the person who elects single coverage, whether they're married, not married, is receiving in the aggregate an incredibly reduced benefit from the town, even though he or she does the exact same work. And what this attempts to do is still come to a balance of promoting family values by having the town pay a very large portion of the dependent care, mm-hmm. of the dependents and spouse, but at the same time not punishing individuals who elect, for whatever reason, single coverage. So that was the compromise reached here, and it's like the glass being half empty or half full. I would suggest in this particular case that this isn't a negative for people with dependents and spouses that want to be covered, but an incredible positive for the town of paying 95%. I wish in my business, or I'm sure most of the employers in Cape Elizabeth wish that they could conceivably afford an insurance package like this for their own employees.
Well, it's just a question that came up on the equal treatment of the one with dependents compared to the single employee.
Further discussion. Councilor Reed.
Can I just make a quick clarification?
You sure can.
In case anyone didn't fully understand the excellent description by Chairman Groff, another way to look at it is everyone receives 100%. We could have, this memo could have been written that everyone receives 100% and the dependents are at 85%. If you were to take the exact dollar amount, if that were more palatable to certain people, because the cost of 100% of the single is included in the percentage of the family.
So that there's no confusion amongst employees.
Oh, yeah, that's right. The other
let's make clear that that's not what that reads, and that the employees had asked very early on that we not have dollar amounts in here. They preferred to have percentages.
And, yes, and I'm sorry, I wasn't suggesting that that should be put in there, but in terms of Mr. Barry's concern about the equal. Sorry.
Again, it was always, people at home, it's always a balancing act of being fair to, attempting to be fair to all town employees, and this council's worked long and hard to attempt to come to a rational compromise where there's no surprises that saving, if there's any savings to be realized by changing in plans, that we're sharing those savings, and that we're attempting to allow people to have good health insurance for their families. And that was, I think, the intent of everybody on the council. We've had the motion and a second. Any further discussion? Vote. All in favor? Opposed? 7-0 in favor.
I didn't catch who moved and seconded. Forgot my clerk's duties there for a second.
Bill and
one. She was two.
Yeah.
Councilor Beyer moved the motion, and Councilor Reed seconded. We now move on to item 83. Action upon recommendation to refer proposed addressing ordinance to the planning board. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, as a result of the enhanced 911, it becomes necessary for us to perhaps do some readdressing of streets, change some street names, but particularly numbers. The emphasis is going to be on numbers. Our ordinance does not clearly provide those rights within it to the degree that the state now recommends that we have. This is language that's primarily prepared by the state Department of Public Safety. We've adapted a committee work consisting of Assessor Bob Consul and the police and fire chiefs. They've adapted it to Cape Elizabeth. I would encourage you to look at this and to pass it on to the planning board for review, both the addressing ordinance change and the proposed amendment to the subdivision ordinance that governs the same issue.
Is there a motion?
I'll move that the addressing ordinances be referred to the planning board for their review and comment.
Second?
Second.
Second by Councilor Jordan. Discussion? Councilor McGinty.
Does this say that the addressing coordinator has the authority to assign names and numbers, assign road names and numbers to all properties? Is that what this says?
This is what it says, but he or she would do it at his peril without reviewing it with the council.
Well, that's note to the planning board.
Further discussion? Call the motion. All in favor? Opposed? Passes 7-0. Item 84, action upon motion permit town treasurer to open an account with Tucker Anthony in order to accept donations of stock and other securities. Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, there's at least one individual, I think there's two now, who want to donate stock to the field for Cape Kids fundraising. In order to transfer stock from one account to another account, and for them to get the tax benefit of it, it's helpful for them to have a brokerage account. This merely would be a temporary holding point, and then we would sell the stock and put it into the Field for Kids.
Not only helpful, but essential.
Essential. And this needs to be on the council agenda because it's also a trail for the auditors to know that they ought to be checking with Tucker Anthony to see if we have any funds there.
Is there a motion? Councilor Reed.
I move that we proceed with the recommendation to permit the town treasurer to open an account with Tucker Anthony in order to accept donations of stock and other securities.
Second. Yeah. Second. Councilor Jordan. Discussion? Councilor McGinty?
Cost of the town on this, Mike?
There is no cost.
No cost. And even when the stocks are sold, no commission costs?
I didn't specifically ask the question. The person who's involved in this is involved with the field for Cape Kids. I would imagine they'll be aggressive within their firm at reducing the commission costs. But I don't know.
You have some info, John?
Yeah, all that usually happens in situations like this, to the extent there's a commission and a town owns it, it's just the commission would get deducted from our proceeds, but it's all donated anyway. So it's, we get the net. So it's really, depends how you view. We'd have to convert it somehow anyway to be able to use it. So I don't really think that's a consideration.
But I would assume that the commission would come out of the donation, not as a cost to the town.
That's right.
Yeah, okay.
It just reduces the contribution a little bit.
How is the broker selected? A local person?
The broker is a local person. And,
okay, good.
He was involved with obtaining the donation of the stock for the Field for Cape Kids group.
Further discussion? Call the motion. All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Motion passes. Item 85. Action to accept all donations given to the town of Cape Elizabeth in 1997. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, Deborah Lane prepared this list of the different donations. People have been generous this year in giving to the fire department for a number of issues, a total of over $3,000. The police department, there's one couple in particular who while not anonymous and are on the names before you, generally like to be anonymous, who have been very, very supportive to the police department. That's used to buy special equipment. Generally, the TV cameras that are used in conjunction with the arrest have been used with these funds. Night vision binoculars, that type of thing. Holiday baskets, Filene's donated some turkeys. We also received a nice check from the Knights of Columbus. QVC, that issue that came before the council a while ago, did send a donation for the use of the park. And we've begun to obtain some funds for the fields for Cape Kids. We've got a list here of library donations. The Museum of Portland Headlight receives about $570. And we also received other fees for filming, one from Unum, a brief, small one from United Airlines, and one from Shaw's, and one from Young's Furniture.
And might I add, this is a good time, since it's near the end of the year, to remind all Cape citizens that there is a Fort Williams Trust that accepts donations. There are the Fields for Kids at this point in time, and there are numerous other things in town that really provide giving opportunities. Again, this is a private-public partnership, and all these gifts are certainly welcomed. And if you have any questions at all about what you can do for the town manager puts those calls on a high priority, don't you?
Yes, sir.
Is there a motion? Councilor Reed.
I move that we accept with thanks the generosity of the gifts and donations listed in the December 12, 1997 memo from the town clerk.
Second, Councilor Jordan. Discussion? Call the motion. All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Item 86, action to authorize town treasurer to open an account with MBIA Municipal Investor Services Service Corporation for the investment of municipal funds. Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, this is just another option for investment of town funds. There is safety, liquidity, with these funds. We're always looking for new opportunities. I don't have any immediate plans to put funds with them. A lot of towns have tended to do it for some of their smaller trust funds because the administrative cost is real low, plus they also, their accounting for it is a lot better than in some of the other institutions in terms of having combined funds. It's not necessarily something I'm going to do. It's simply going to be rate-based, and just, when we go to the banks, when we go to other institutions, this is just one more option we'll be looking at.
Is there any cost?
Every way, banks have cost, everyone, there's no direct cost, but there is a yield that they get when they figure out their investment percentages.
No, but the action to open an account incurs no cost. Is that right? And before any monies were put in such an account, there would at least be some discussion with whoever the town council was at that time. Is that anticipated?
No.
Or just that would be up to the manager?
It would be up to the town treasurer, who's also the town manager working with the business manager. But this would be the authorization of the town council, and is the notice to the auditors as well that they should check with MBIA to see if we have any funds there.
Is there a motion? Councilor Reed.
I move that we authorize the town treasurer to open an account with MBIA Municipal Investor Service Corporation for the investment of municipal funds.
Second. Councilor Second. Jordan. Further discussion?
Quick question. Just to Mike, are you comfortable that the principal is secure?
Yes.
Thank you.
Further discussion? Call Councilor Reed.
Question of the town manager. Do you still have your investment advisory group or whatever it's called intact?
Yes. They meet on an infrequent basis. I've spoken with some of the gentlemen who are on it. They are all gentlemen at this point in the last couple of weeks, and a lot of them tend to head south during the winter, but I'm going to try to get them together again in the spring.
Thank you.
Further discussion? Hearing none, call the motion. All in favor? Opposed? Passes 7-0. Item 87, action to relieve the planning board of the requirement to review a proposed amendment to the zoning ordinance, which has subsequently been withdrawn by the applicant. Mr. McGovern.
Yeah, you've received a proposal at an earlier meeting from the Cape Elizabeth Land Company. As you can see, Mr. Frinsco representing Cape Elizabeth Land Company sent a letter to the council chairman indicating that they'd like to withdraw it. The planning board tabled it at their meeting last month. And this simply would be a pro forma action to put it on the council record that this issue is now dead and the council is no longer asking the planning board to review it.
Is there a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I move to relieve the planning board of responsibility to review proposed zoning ordinance amendment from the Cape Elizabeth Land Company.
Second.
Councilor McGinty, further discussion? All, call the motion, all in favor? Opposed? Passes unanimously. Well, I take that back. I am not sure, and I want to be extremely cautious on this. One of my law partners, and I know absolutely nothing about this, has indicated that perhaps one of the individuals who's involved in
the land company,
and I don't even know who, he might be against in a case. And if I sound vague, it's because I am vague. And I didn't want to know anything about it. So for that reason, since I'm just going to abstain, and I don't know if it's necessary for me to recuse myself because I don't know enough about it, but just to make the record clear, I'm going to abstain from voting on this matter. Okay.
So that's a 6-0 vote?
It's a 6-0 vote with one abstention. I don't want to call it a recusal because I don't have enough information to make that call.
Right.
Let's see. Action upon motion to enter executive session to discuss land acquisition slash disposition, collective bargaining and pending litigation. It's item 88.
So moved.
Second.
Citizen discussion first.
Yeah, so we should first, before we do that, is there anybody in the audience, any citizen that wishes to discuss some item that has not been covered tonight? All right, hearing none, we have a motion and a second to go into executive session for the reasons stated. Councilor Jordan?
I have one comment to make. Should I make it before we vote?
Sure.
I still would like to know what the posts are along the end of the poor farm.
Yes.
Up into the field, and can you answer my question?
I know it has something to do with the trail, but I personally have not been down there, and I intend to do it.
It has nothing to do with the snowmobile trail.
No, it's nothing to do with snowmobile. I will go down this week. I'll go down tomorrow.
Will you do that?
Tomorrow.
I know
council has a workshop on next Monday. I'll put that on the agenda to report back to the council. And if anyone else wants to know what they are, I'll do it in writing so they can ask for a copy of the report.
Thank you.
Now, before we vote on this motion to enter executive session, it is anticipated tonight that we will come back into public session.
Yes.
I don't know if I doubt that will be on television at that time on your cable. I would urge all the citizens of Cape Elizabeth to, if they have any question about what happened at that public session, that executive session, and then to the extent that it's revealed and voted upon in public session, they certainly can call Town Hall, and hopefully, there is a distinct possibility it will be news that's good news and that everyone will be interested in hearing it.
If there is any action that comes out of the executive session, we will fax to both the Press Herald and notify the Courier tomorrow of it, so word will be up with
you. So you might read about it. So is there a, let's vote on the motion to go into executive session. All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. We're going to executive session.
Work tonight.
Good night. Thank you very much.
Yeah, you got it.